ReleaseWire helps businesses connect with interested journalists and bloggers. Check out the link in the description to save 25% on your first press release.
Admiral, radar shows that we have liberals approaching at 3 o'clock, and libertarians at 9 o'clock, and conservatives at 6 o'clock. They're coming from every angle, every viewpoint.
Oh, it's Political Radar with your hosts, Rhonda and Elliot.
Hey, all you political junkies, welcome to Political Radar, the best 30 minutes of unscripted and uncensored political talk you will hear all day long, episode 66, and we have in the studio with us today, Brown County Executive Troy Streckenbach. Welcome to the show.
Morning.
Troy, thanks for being on.
It's my pleasure.
We don't have a lot of time with you because you're a busy man, and this is a half-hour show, but there's so much to cover because the county has, there's a lot going on.
Yes, there is. I mean, quickly for your listeners and viewers, Brown County represents roughly 32 departments and divisions. We have 1,700 employees, and I have over 20 different people that directly report to me. So we're a very diverse organization. We have we oversee courts to 911 center, airports, the port, solid waste, museums, libraries, parks, the new zoo. So the list goes on in terms of the things that we have contact with and oversee. So it's a pretty diverse, and quite frankly, we're a key component to the overall success of the community. And if not Brown County, but Northeast Wisconsin being the fourth largest county and the third largest city in the region.
Can you actually talk about what your position is, what you do for the county?
So Brown County, a long time ago, decided to have a county executive form of government. Counties can have three different choices. One would be where the county board oversees and administers the overall organization. Brown County decided a couple of years ago, that it was going to have a county executive form of government. And my constitutional authority is basically the county board legislates the budget and policy, and it's my responsibility then to administer those policies and that budget.
And you've been doing that for how long?
I'm in my second term. Okay. The terms are 4 years each. And let's see here. I think I'm in my sixth year.
Wow. Okay. Okay, great. So what we're going to do today is we're going to actually go through a little bit of a rapid fire questioning. There's a lot, like as you said, there's a lot of initiatives. There's a lot of issues. There's a lot of ideas out there. There's a lot of projects happening and developing right now. And so we want to get to a few. We had a few people just ask us to touch on some, and then we're going to get to some bigger, more newsworthy items. So first of all, the
East Side Library.
Yeah, East Side Library.
Boom.
All right. So East Side Library.
Go.
Right now, the library board is trying to make a determination as to what the next strategy is for that site. Right now, we are in a lease situation where the current branch is located. That lease is coming up in 2018. And so the library needs to make a decision as to whether or not they're going to continue at that site or if there's an opportunity for it to relocate and develop a place where it's going to be for the next generation. So right now the library board is examining a number of different options for it to consider. One of those was the UW Extension site, and we can talk about that in a little bit. So right now they're debating whether or not they go into this East Town Mall project or if they remain in their current location.
Is Andy Nicholson on the library board by any chance? Because it's, as we know, he doesn't really think we need libraries. We have the internet, so we don't need libraries. Is he on there?
He is not.
Okay.
But he does control. He is one of the county board supervisors who ultimately has a vote in the library's budget.
We kind of probably know where he's going with that. Okay, next. The future of the public health division on Broadway, that building.
Sure.
Right now, what's happening?
So the county board has authorized the last 2 years for me to relocate the health department into the Sophie Beaumont building, which is downtown right next to the northern building. We haven't done that because for the most part, Brown County has about 2.2 million square feet that we're responsible for overseeing. And we are trying to basically, we don't want to make a decision because a lot of the decisions that we make have long-lasting impacts. And so we want to make sure that when we make this decision, it is something that we know that will be either something that will last for 5 years at minimum, or it's going to be something that's going to take place for 30 years. The point being is that the health department, currently we are leasing that space out. We spend about $120,000 of taxpayers' local money to be in that operation and that location. When long-term care rolled out and the state took it over, family care, the Sophie Beaumont building lost roughly 65 employees and freed up about 10,000 square feet. And so that space is still there. It's still being heated. We're still paying for the maintenance on the roof. There's still the physical space. And so we have 10,000 square feet that is available for us to potentially move the health department in there.
What's the difference between what you're using now at the building on Broadway and that building?
It's relatively about the same. Okay. If you look at the actual usage of space versus the total square footage that we're leasing, it comes out to be right just below 10,000 square feet. Okay. The space that's there is about 12,000 square feet, but when you look at the size of the corridors, the hallways, and you actually look at the use of the space, you get down below 10,000.
And you would think that, according to where it's at, the location, it would probably be utilized and a lot easier access to get to the building.
Well, and so that would be what I would believe, but at the same time, the health department is different than human services. Human services, people come to them because they need the services from the federal government or the state or the county. Health department is trying to remove barriers and encourage people to come to them because we are hoping to be able to give them vaccinations, to give them, updates on education. So from that standpoint, they're looking at removing barriers. So if we move them downtown, and so this is one of the reasons why we haven't moved yet. And why we're still considering is we want to make sure that when we make the decision, it is the right decision in terms of the overall missions of each of the two different departments. But I want to go back to the $120,000. So in county government, we are constantly trying to figure out how we can increase the revenue in terms of operating our business, operating the services of government. And when we have growth that is not strong enough in order to support the overall operations, we're constantly looking for efficiencies, savings. How can we run government more efficient? And so from my perspective, I see that we have space over here that's underutilized and we're paying for rent over here at this other location. We could take that $120,000 and reprogram that back into programs and services such as child abuse and neglect, mental health, you name it. We could take that money and put it back into actual programs and services versus going into, basically operational budgets. So from our perspective, we're trying to figure out how can we use that money and bring it over and consolidate, reduce the county's overall footprint.
That sounds like a no-brainer.
I mean, those services seemed like those services would be more of an impact for people's lives if you did make that move.
So it in essence, So on the surface level, it makes sense. But when you get into the weeds and you start talking to the departments and the different divisions within the departments, you start to recognize that, hey, before we go forward with this, let's make sure that we have the right decision. Now, we've been examining this for the last 2 years. We know that we can make it happen. But again, we have a lot of buildings. We are trying to make the best decision to go forward. The county board has given us the authorization to do it. There was a recent communication by Supervisor Shadwell that said, hey, as we are determining and looking at what we're going to do with our county facilities, maybe we should start thinking about more of a regional approach, and maybe we should think about going out to where our community treatment center is, where our 911 center is, where our jail is, where we have a lot of land, and maybe perhaps as the state and is encouraging counties to become more regional in their approach, this might be something that we want to look at.
Where is this in the process as far as moving over to another location and acquiring that space? Where is it? So people are watching and listening there, this isn't happening yet.
No. So it's just right now it's a communication that was sent to the administration to examine. Again, we know that we can make the move to the current location. My basic determination was, how long would it take us to pay off for that move to the current, you know, the Sophie Beaumont building. And right now the cost to us pick up and move and build a new lab into the Sophie Beaumont is about $360,000. Mm. And so in essence, that takes us about 3 years for us to pay off that investment. So from my standpoint, anything that was below 5 years, we should make the move. And then if the county is considering building a larger facility or a new facility that becomes more efficient or does the services of the community for the next generations, those things that we should be discussing and debating going forward.
Okay, great. So let's get to really great thing that's happening in the community, the STEM Innovation Center. I want you to talk about that.
So, you know, the STEM Innovation Center is if you sit back and you think about what you're hearing, not only in the state of Wisconsin, but the United States or globally, there is a push to make sure that we are encouraging young students, young minds to be encouraged in science, technology, engineering, and math. But if you kind of boil down and you start to think about what is going to be the next generation of entrepreneurs and businesses in our community, and I think I've seen you, Elliot, post on AI and artificial intelligence and where innovation and technology is going to be taking us. And you sit back and you wonder, okay, where is that taking place? Where is that innovation taking place? It's not happening here. And the reason why it's not happening here is because, unfortunately, we don't have the direct correlation between our university and our private sector. Now, in the short term, we absolutely need to have a pipeline. And we need to be encouraging our young minds to get interested in these fields because we're going to have an aging out system. And there's going to be a major demand in our workforce with our industries to fill those jobs of the future. And if we're not able to have the workforce to supply those jobs for those businesses are going to have to look to go elsewhere. And so the biggest challenge that Northeast Wisconsin, so I talk about, when we talk about STEM, I really look at it as a Northeast Wisconsin issue. If we can't figure this out, we're going to be in a very interesting predicament in the future, because the community that figures out how to actually attract and retain people is going to be the community that actually is successful in the future. And so the Brown County, although our population will grow, the region is losing people. And we're losing people to Milwaukee County, Dane County, Hennepin County in Minnesota, Cook County in Chicago area.
Why do you think that is? I mean, what do you think the reason is for that?
Well, so, you know, in our determinations, the things that we started back in 2014 examining, why is it that we have a net outflow of people and why don't we have a net inflow? And that's really what we're trying to accomplish with the STEM Innovation Center. Short term is to fill to support and make sure that we can retain a strong manufacturing industry. The second part is the long term opportunities for innovation and research to take place here.
So, what is this? What is this center? Is this college students, high school students? Like what?
So, the STEM Innovation Center really is a ecosystem of collaboration between higher ed and UW Extension, land conservation, programming through the Einstein Project, through the Green Bay School Districts, any other school district that wants to take place. It's really a center of, let's put it this way, I'd like to see a child who's working on a Lego robot be able to walk across the hall and see university professors teaching students about applied science or robotics.
Yeah, that's amazing.
And so the key there, though, is that child then gets the idea and the opportunity to see the creativity and imagination so that they can actually see something. So you think about when we grew up, we thought about going to the moon, or
we are young and we're still growing up.
Yes, I agree. But, you know, at the end of the day, we need to,
Okay, so you painted this visual of walking across the hall, but I teach Introduction to Computer Science at UWGB.
Okay.
So are you saying I'm going to have to relocate? Like what do you envision on all that?
So our goal is that as the University of Green Bay pursues its mechanical engineering, that they'll actually be housed in this building. And so from that standpoint, you'll have actually the mechanical engineering being taught there. The College of Science and Technology, through John Caters, who's the dean, is looking at other programs and curriculum that can actually be taught there. So the other aspect of this is land conservation right now. So if you've noticed anything that we're doing from the county with the demonstration farms, the things that we're trying to do to prevent phosphorus and nitrate going into the watershed, you would notice that we are trying to educate generations of landowners how to protect their water or protect their land. How do you keep the nitrates or the soil healthy? Rebuild the soil so that when we have the 14-day re-invents, instead of it running off, it actually stays and is absorbed by the soil. Why I say this is important, because it leads to the other partner, UW Extension. The UW Extension, we're teaching parents and children the importance of seed to plate. And in order to understand the seed to plate, you have to understand where it's, how it's grown. So as we're teaching people how to, you know, grow their own food and community gardens, and they understand how their food comes to them, there's a product, there's a process in growing that food. So I'd like to see these children be able to go out from the classroom, go outside into a living classroom, outdoor classroom, and see how that food is produced. And then the way the food is produced, the way they manage that soil, has a direct impact to the watershed. So in the land, we're hoping that we have tributaries that actually lead. And so now the UWGB can come forward and say and show and teach. So you have now the imagination. So when you think about Brown County and going back to the STEM Innovation Center, what it really is looking at is then that next generation, that future innovation. We have four clusters in this area that are very strong. We have healthcare. So water is a very critical importance to the health of our community. We have waste or resource recovery. So the management of our waste stream is in critical importance. You have the manufacturing and food processing. All these things are right here in our community, and we have a strong manufacturing, strong private side. Our university is strong there, but what we haven't had is the convergence of the two to come together. And so what we're hoping through the STEM Innovation Center, short term, is the filled up workforce pipeline. Long term is the entrepreneurs and innovation, so that when I'm standing in a demonstration farm, I'm witnessing a machine coming through planting cover crops. And I ask where that machine came from, and they say it came from the University of Pennsylvania. And I'm going, why didn't that come here? Because right now, federal government is bringing in hundreds of millions of dollars right into our watershed to try to figure out how to solve the water quality and the phosphorus runoff. And so I think there's a perfect opportunity for our food processing, our watershed stewardship, our healthcare, all to come together with the higher education to try to come up with those solutions right here. Instead of us importing those solutions, let's try to export them. The last thing I'll say on this whole thing is that in 2011, UW Extension did a study of the 5,200 companies that moved in the state of Wisconsin. 4,200 of them only moved within 10 miles of their current location. And what that meant to me is that our focus and our energy should be really about our internal, our network here. And what we need to be doing is supporting the university by increasing their overall enrollment, because they have a 70% retention rate. So if they're below or right around 7,000 today, if we can get them up to 10,000, 15,000, we have more people coming to this workforce. We have more people that potentially could be in the next generation of entrepreneur, where they had an idea either in their basement, in their garage, and they grew it from 1 to 10 to 50 to 100. And that's the succession plan for a community that's absolutely necessary, because when you're losing those companies, when they're getting bought out for the natural cycle of a business, if we're not replacing it, what is the overall fabric of our community going to look like? When you talk about volunteerism, you look at the corporate welfare in terms of what they're doing to promote volunteerism and resources to the nonprofits that make up our community, the overall fabric.
So this STEM center, is this a building or is it an idea? I'm a little fuzzy on.
So it's actually a building. It's about 55,000 square feet.
On Bellevue Street, correct?
No. So that's the UW Extension site that we're going to be selling, okay, if approved by the county board and the Green Bay School District. This building right now is tentatively going to be located out at, the county owns 240 acres of land. We've promoted this as being the Research and Innovation Park. This will be the first seed in terms of our vision of about bringing research and innovation to this area, changing the flow of people. We want the brain gain versus brain drain. I know that if we have 3,000 students coming up here, that inside that 3,000 students, there are individuals who will potentially fill the workforce pipeline that we need, but we also have in there a percentage of individuals who want to be an engineer, that want to work with our private sector, that want to come up with a solution of a process. And I want that to be happening here because that brain power is going somewhere. So, and so the building is 55,000 square feet. Oh. It'll house Einstein Project. It'll house UW Extension. It'll house Lancon. It'll house the University of Green Bay's engineering. And it will house a, these are some things that we're still working out, the 3GI gigabyte initiative. It'll house community programming space for the school districts, NWTC. So right now we have a committee that is actually working on the actual space and utilization, but those are the main components to it.
And this seems to be a lot of everything you just mentioned, this is all happening already. It's just bringing it all together. Why has it taken so long to put this out where you wanted to bring it all together?
Well,
this started a while ago, right?
Well, I mean, at the end of the day, yeah, it has. I mean, but you got to kind of rewind and think about, so there's a lot of people doing STEM, a lot of people that are engaged. The school districts are encouraging, you know, our museum, our library, our parks, our UW Extension to come into the classroom or go into the outdoor living areas or to learn about the importance of STEM. What we haven't had and what we're missing yet is the key component, and that has been the university. So 25 years ago or plus, this community actually, when the federal government changed its grant process, this county actually, its leadership, not necessarily Brown County leadership, but the community leaders in this area started to talk about research and innovation here. But unfortunately, the politics didn't allow it to happen. And so fast forward today, we now have our NWTC, Jeff Raffin. We have our Chancellor Miller. We have Green Bay School Districts all converging together along with the Einstein Project. The county all saying this is an absolute need. And when you talk about the project, we had in 2 weeks, the 60 business leaders in our community sign off on a letter that I brought down to the governor's office on December 22nd. In 2 weeks, we were able to get the major CEOs in this community to sign off on the importance of the governor, including in his budget, $5 million to help this private-public partnership collaboration to build the center to help fill the short-term need for workforce development and our long-term ambition and vision for research and innovation in changing the flow of people to Northeast Wisconsin versus the flow out. And so our main objective from 100,000 feet above this is really to change the flow and make Northeast Wisconsin sustainable for a long time.
And what is the price tag on that?
So right now we have roughly a $15 million cost associated with this building.
Okay. So I don't understand the tactics of this. So the strategy is we want to stem the flow, and or I'm mixing metaphors there, right?
Sure.
But okay, so I teach at GB. Am I moving down to this building?
I don't know where you would be moving.
So I guess what I'm wondering is there's all these students. They're at a high school. They're at NWTC. They have, you know, they have to take all these different types of classes.
Sure.
It's only going to be engineering stuff that's in this center, right?
So right now, as I said earlier, that you have the John Caters, the dean of the College of Science and Technology, working with the group to talk about what type of programming and curriculum will be actually taught at this location. We know that right now that the mechanical engineering is slated to be one of the components. And in the process of discussion, we are looking at other options to be located in this building as well.
You know what I mean? Like, from a student standpoint, students don't have a lot of money. Transportation can be an issue. So, like, how do you kind of help with that?
Sure. So right now, if you're not familiar with where the site is, it's literally across Highway 57 from it.
From GB.
From GB.
Okay. So it
is still a distance. And yeah. Let's not, we're not closing the door in terms of site. Right now, the county has 240 acres of land that has been tried to be developed many different times. And so when the Medical College of Wisconsin was looking to come to Green Bay, the city of Green Bay and Brown County partnered together with Advance to said, let's try to bring it here, and we're going to develop this land for development in medical area because of the proximity to the clinic, the VA clinic, the community treatment center, new curative, or now it's called Connective Connections. So we thought that we had a pretty nice package to offer. From that, we realized, though, that this land is sitting idle, and we've been trying to figure out how to develop it because the county has a lot of land, and we're trying to activate it. So one of the thoughts was to make this into a research innovation, and the reason why we did that is because when we saw the successful communities in the United States and where we saw people traveling or going to Asheville, Fargo, North Dakota, Austin, Nashville, the list kind of goes on, and you start to sit there and wonder what is going on in those communities that we're not doing. Not all of them, but a very strong, there was a strong correlation between higher ed, research and innovation with their private sector. And that's something that we don't have here in Brown County or in Northeast Wisconsin. And our main mission out of this whole objective is short term, we need to make sure that we're supplying the workforce of for the manufacturing. Long term is for research and innovation taking place here locally. And so when we look at that 240 acres of land in this site, it's the proximity to the university. But there might be an opportunity for the county to get land at the university. As long as this is going to be a designated area for growth, for research and innovation, and it can be located closer to the university or on the university campus, that's a topic that we'll continue to look at.
What do you see as far as the timeline involved in bringing this to fruition?
From our perspective, we would like to see either in 2018 or 2019. Yeah. The governor's budget is the 2017-2019, so we're going to want to make sure that we take advantage of that.
And that money is secured. It's been approved, where is it at? That's what I'd like to know.
So it still has to go through the legislative process, right. And then it eventually has to be signed off on when the governor signs the budget.
And is this project contingent on that approval with the state legislature?
I think it's a very important component. It shows that the state recognizes that Northeast Wisconsin's success is going to be that the state is involved in workforce development. I think that was one of the more compelling arguments that was made to the governor. And quite frankly, it was supported by those 60 CEOs in our community that basically said, absolutely, we need this to happen because in order for us to be successful in Northeast Wisconsin, we need to have these pipelines filled in the future.
And so really, this is not necessarily a partisan, this wouldn't be a great thing to take a partisan side for. This is really a collaboration and something that everyone will benefit from.
I would say that I would agree with you, of course. However, I don't see partisan. I think I would say that our area delegation in Northeast Wisconsin would be supportive of this, but I can't say that from the Southeast region or the West region of Wisconsin. They may not necessarily feel that this is a good investment. Now, we are going into the capital budget. It's a non-state agency request. It's similar to the $2 million that the mayor received through the building of the KI Convention Center. So this was for tourism. We're looking at actually workforce development and success of our manufacturing base here in Northeast Wisconsin.
Well, it seems like a very solid project, so I hope it gets done.
I agree with you. And then the day what we've looked at is really when we think about the clusters and the things that we are really strong in at currently, and we look at that 2011 study, we need to be growing our own. But in order for us to grow on our own and invest in our own community and invest in our own people, we actually have to have a flow of people coming here. We need to have a net inflow, and we need to have brain gain. And so that is the ultimate long-term objective. The short-term objective is, how do I get my kids, even my children, interested in science, technology, and engineering and math? It's somewhat of a struggle because they have, three-second sound bites hitting them at every angle. And, when Elon Musk, I hope I said his name right, when he mentioned that he was going to be sending two people to travel around the moon, you know, I wonder what my kids think of that. Do they ever think that they could potentially do that? Could they think about building the machine that allows that to happen? And I don't know if that's necessarily going through their brains right now. And so my hope and goal out of a lot of this is to re-engage the imagination of our youth to think about the possibilities of the future.
And be visionary at the same time. I think that's what's missing. It's everything is so quick and immediate and instant gratification. No one really has, they don't have a lot of vision. That just stops right there.
Yeah, the 3 second sound bites, it's tough. I mean,
so speaking of 3 second sound bites, we're just about out of time. Any closing thoughts you got?
I think, you know, the way the county, you know, attempts to try to resolve a lot of the issues that it has in front of it is with plans. I mean, we talked earlier off camera about the county's 5-year plan with the bike and pedestrian.
Which that's actually another episode, and we'd love to have you come back at some time to talk about that, because I think that needs
we have a lot of people interested in that.
That needs a lot of time.
So that actually correlates with our 6-year plan for our roads. And what a lot of people don't know is that we're actually into our third year to bring all of our roads, all the roads that the county has under its auspice, into the fair good rating with the PACER rating. Now, that didn't happen overnight. That required some leadership from my public works director, Paul Fentecchio, who basically said, Troy, we have an infrastructure problem. I'm going to be doing a baseline of where we're at, and I'm going to come back to you with a budget request to be able to fulfill that. That included an additional $2 million in bonding over those course of 5 years. So at the same time we're having that debate and discussion, we brought in our planning department, who are looking at it, because the increased awareness and need for bike facilities and pedestrian walkways became more and more of a conversation. And so we wanted to make sure that when we're doing certain road projects, we want to make sure that we're looking at those road projects, and does that meet in the plan that's been adopted by the Planning Commission for our county roads to have bike facilities. So we mirrored those two together. So in the next 5 years, the roads that we're constructing, if they were identified in the Planning Commission for bike facilities, those roads will be completed to have them. So,
and that's definitely a quality of life issue that will retain and, you know, attract and retain people to be staying in this community as well.
It is absolutely one of the number one things that we continue to hear in terms of the success of a community is part of having that.
So will you come back and talk to us about that in April?
At length.
Yeah.
I don't know if that's a 30-minute conversation, but I think there's a...
She can make anything into a 30-minute conversation.
I can, and I will.
Yeah. So if anybody would like to get in touch with you, how would you prefer they do that?
You know, they can go onto the county's website. There's my contact information, 920-448-4001. The county email address is really long, so I'm not necessarily saying that. But
I'll put it into our show notes.
It's there on the website. Outside of that, you know, I have an open door policy. I'm generally a fair person who looks at the community in terms of a long-term strategy. And my ultimate goal in terms of the way I look at my time as a county executive is very short-term in terms of the continuum of what our community is going to look like. And I'm hoping that the things that I'm trying to do will make our community much more successful in the long run, more sustainable. And, you know, just to give you an example, you know, solid waste. Nobody wanted a landfill in their backyard, right? It's one of the hardest things to site in terms of, you know, bringing a real problem that a community needs to address. We've changed the name of our department to resource recovery because we don't look at landfills as long-term success. We actually want to go into that waste stream and find, and here comes the STEM Innovation Center. Maybe I have a young kid who says, boy, if I become an engineer, maybe I can figure out what to do with these fluorescent bulbs or some of the things that we can't actually throw into the garbage. We have an opportunity to work with our private sector, our higher education, and to come up with solutions that, to solve some of our community problems. And the good thing is that the county recognizes those opportunities, and we're trying to find small ways that we can collaborate in those solutions.
Sounds great. That wraps up episode 66 of Political Radar. Thanks, Troy.
Thank you.
Yeah. You can go get show notes on this episode, and I took a bunch of notes if you didn't hear me clickety-clacketing there. So there should be some good, robust show notes for you to read up on the STEM Innovation Center and all that other stuff. I hope I'm looking into the right camera because we switch things around. You want to read those show notes, go to politicalradar.com/66 for episode 66. And please come into the Political Radar community on Facebook and join us in the conversation about the STEM Innovation Center and all sorts of other crazy stuff that everybody posts there. And I'm always on there. That's probably the easiest way to reach me. If you'd like to come on, please let us know. And anything else to add, Brenda?
No, you can reach me on Facebook and at Sitna Cow on Twitter.
All right. Thanks.
Thanks.
Out. Bye.
Thanks for listening to Political Radar. To ensure that you never miss an episode, subscribe on iTunes or your favorite podcast app. To stay up to date, visit politicalradar.com or connect with us on Facebook or Twitter.